Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick coming to you live by satellite from the Philippines. Hope you guys are doing all right. I loaded that video yesterday. It took more than 8 hours to process, so I guess it came out last night. A little message and a prayer request. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've got an awesome dream from the Lord to make a video about. And then the first message I wanted to talk to you guys about was about Bruce Jenner. And I, you know, like I say, I usually don't get into politics too much, but this is spiritual meeting the natural. And so I think I'll title this video, Bruce Jenner. It's Baphomet has found a host. It's really true, brothers and sisters. It's really true. When I was a kid, I've been thinking about this for the last couple of days. When I was a kid, you know, Bruce Jenner won decathlon, or is it whatever it is he won there, triathlon, and he was a big, you know, hero, and he was on the Wheaties cereal, and they had the Wheaties commercials with Bruce Jenner, and so Bruce Jenner is an example of everything that's wrong with America, brothers and sisters, everything that's wrong. He is an example, and if you guys have been following me, I had a dream. And I didn't even really know. I'd only heard of Baphomet one time and seen a picture one time way back. And I had a dream of all these different, fighting all these different forces of evil, on and on and on. And finally there was a giant, you know, evil person, or, you know, actually a fallen angel who I could not defeat. And he kept laughing at me, and I was like, "What is your name?" And he says, "Baphomet." And I woke up. I've got a video about that. In that dream, you know, the reason why I know is from the Lord, even though, of course, I knew it was from the Lord because the presence of the Lord was there when I woke up. But in my dream, it was a man. And then when I was fighting him and stabbing him with the sword, he was laughing and laughing. And then he turned into a woman and tried to kiss me. And then I was like, "Who are you?" He says, "I am Baphomet." And it woke me up. And it was echoing in my head. And so all the dreams and visions that the Lord has given me, I have a bibliographer. Now, not a biographer. A biographer is someone that does your life story. But a bibliographer, I have a person that God has made a way for this person to be my bibliographer. And they always, you know, have a, you know, a catalog the dreams and visions. Because my titles have, in the past, when I first started, were not very organized at all. Still not very organized. But Sister Rosemary Kelly, who helped me, you know, edit and did the bibliography for the book that I wrote, she's will know which videos that I talked about these things on, and I'll ask her, and then we can put links on here. But the point is that Bruce Jenner is he's got breast of a woman, hair of a woman, all that, just like Baphomet. But yet he says he's not gay. And what's so crazy, brothers and sisters, what he says, because I read some of the excerpts, there was a story with excerpts from his interview, and he said, "I'm not gay that I know of." I'm not saying it exactly the way he did. I'm paraphrasing what he said. "I don't think I'm gay. I'm not gay as far as I know," is what he said. So this guy's like 60 years old and he's not gay as far as he knows? I mean, come on. I mean, all of this nonsense about people being born that way, like Lady Gaga, you know, "Baby, I was born this way." Yeah, guess what? We were all born with original sin. You know, I was born with a propensity, you know, to rob banks. You know, rape, murder, and pillage, but I'm not doing it. That doesn't make it right because I was born, you know, with original sin. You know, homosexuality is a sin. But of course, in Bruce Jenner's case, he says he's not gay, but yet he wants to have breasts of a woman, dress like a woman, body of a woman, you know, get his Adam's apple shaved off, all this stuff, become transgender but not transsexual. He still wants to sleep with women and still, you know, be a dad and have kids. And be, you know, two moms or whatever. He said, I would just want to be called she, you know. And this is bizarre, demonic confusion, brothers and sisters. This is strong delusion. And it's everything wrong with America. And I know that's why the devil picked Bruce Jenner. I mean, look at Bruce Jenner. He is a living, walking example of everything wrong with the States. He's a personification of everything that's wrong with the United States. And I want to say this, reference back, because this is the message that the Lord gave me for the American church. The final boarding call, Satan's plan for the ages, and our last mission. This is a walking example of that, brothers and sisters. Of course, it all really went down in the 50s and 60s. All the groundwork was laid. And so by the time Bruce Jenner, you know, was in the 70s, I mean, we're already in the liberation period. But as an example, J. Edgar Hoover, you know, this is what my relatives who claim they're Christian, but they're, they could, you know, abortion should be allowed, and they're pro-gay marriage and all that stuff. They're alleged Christians, they'll say, well, you know, we've always had, you know, weird people. J. Edgar Hoover was a transvestite. You know, that's a little known fact. He was a cross-dresser. But you know what? He didn't tell anybody he was gay. You know, his sidekick there was his lover. They kind of brought it out in that movie about him recently, and I saw it on an airplane one time when I was flying back and forth to the Philippines. J. Edgar Hoover would kill people to keep it a secret because it was not sociably acceptable. In America, pre-1970s, and even getting, and it's exploded now, calling good evil and evil good. You know, Bruce Jenner is just now, he says he's felt this way since he was a kid. He's just now able to publicly come out by it and considered a hero. You know, when Ellen, look at how fast our country's fallen. When Ellen DeGeneres had her TV show, and by the way, you know, I don't have nothing against Ellen. You know, as a comedian, I like Ellen DeGeneres. She's, you know, she seems like a nice person, but her girlfriend or wife or whatever she was accusing her of beating her and stuff. Who knows, you know. But anyway, when Ellen DeGeneres was on TV and she came out as gay in her TV show to try to promote the homosexual lifestyle, her show got canceled. Now that was only, what, 10 years ago? Or maybe it was, it might have been in the late 90s. So it might have been 15 years ago, I don't remember. But all I know was it was a big deal just that recently. You know, Will and Grace had the gay guy on there. It was controversial and it was introducing it. Just so fast, brothers and sisters. We're just talking about in the last 10, 20 years. But the groundwork for these things was laid when the Supreme Court in the 1950s was as it is maximum amount of illuminated thinkers. The maximum amount of Masonic, Illuminati influence in the United States that was visible was the 1950s, when the highest number of Masons was on the Supreme Court. That's when they changed the laws and laid the groundwork for what we see today. Than the 1960s. I mean, think about it. The people say, oh, there was always, since they made photography, there's been some stag films, pornography. But it was hidden. It was like, you know, you go downtown to the perverted, you know, there used to be the gay neighborhood in New York, and they had a big, I think it's a Hay Street, no, Hay Street riot, that's in Chicago, the May Day riot there, really the birth of communism and socialist movement in the United States, before Russia, you know, that was the birth of it, the Hay Street riots. There's a famous gay bar there in New York in the 1960s. The police used to go there supposedly and harass them and arrest them, you know, for sodomy and all this. And then they had a big rebellious thing. And then they backed off, you know, of prosecuting sodomy and all that stuff up there in New York City, maybe in the 50s or 60s time period. I forgot the name of the place. But anyway, brothers and sisters, all the groundwork for this was laid through the court system and all that in the 50s and the 60s. As I talked about many times in videos and in the book, Aleister Crowley, you know, was the forefather of all these things. I'm bringing forth this, you know, all I should make, I can make a long video and go on and on and on about this. Bruce Jenner is the personification of that. He's a living personification of everything's wrong. Here he was, an Olympic athlete, hero, manly man, a man's man, even though he was already in the 70s when it became girly man time already. You know, the men looking like women with long hair and dressing like women. It was already going on. The sexual revolution and all this was already passed through the hard part of it. It was getting to where it was just pushing forward. Anyway, so, and then now he's, you know, he's celebrated as a hero again for being a freak, having the breast and the hair and all this of a woman, then still trying to operate as a man. It looked exactly like Baphomet, a freak. And I'm telling you, this goes into the next dream that the Lord gave me about the old Pope, Pope Ratzinger, who's still alive. Cardinal Ratzinger, who's whatever, is Pope Benedict. The glory of the olive, as the Lord had reminded me, his name means the Benedictine order, is the glory of the olive. What is the Olivet Discourse, brothers and sisters? That's why he's known as the glory of the olive, that Benedictine. It's talking about the end times, the tribulation period, the glory of the tribulation period. That's my whole next video. Let me just give you a teaser on that and say this. The problem with people's dogmatic mindset and judgmental attitude, brothers and sisters, I will say this. You will be surprised who's really a Christian and who makes it to heaven, who makes it in the rapture. You'll be surprised who's left behind. Let me give you a clue. James Robeson, would shock me. What's his name? The one who says he's a little god out there in Missouri. I was just thinking of before. Kenneth Copeland. They endorse the Pope. They've embraced the new Pope and his doctrine. Old Brokeback, Saddleback, Mountain Church, purpose-driven life. The Protestant spokesman for this Pope who went there as his ambassador to these denominations, he was killed in a motorcycle wreck. And I believe that was a sign from God. Okay, brothers and sisters, sorry for that interruption. I had to have a little spot there because I heard some noise outside. I went to check it out. What's going on? Anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. Praise the living God for the light that we have. People are so blinded and deceived. As I said, you're going to be surprised who's really Christian and not. I'm going to make another video about it. Martin Luther, and I've said this before, and Sister Rosemary Kelly, who's my bibliographer, I'm going to ask her to help me make a playlist, and I'm going to put a link down here and on the next video about all the dreams and stuff the Lord showed me about the Pope and all that, and the American church, because it's all coming together, brothers and sisters. It's coming together, what the Lord is showing me. It's common sense. Your old mainline Protestant denominations are the biggest enemies of God. They deny the Bible. They deny the Word of God. The problem is there's people that just came back to the Lord a few years ago. You know, now they're suddenly claiming that they're, you know, they got a little bit of Jewish blood and they're wearing a yarmulke and trying to speak Hebrew and some authority and all this stuff. People on YouTube, and they're blanketing and saying, you know, all these people are evil. I want to tell you, God's got his remnant everywhere. And just like what I'm telling you, the vast majority of the Antichrist spirit in the church that you're going to find is in your old mainline Protestant denominations. They are the ones who were refusing to do business with Israel and boycott Israel. They are the ones that have a bar in their denominational headquarters, like the Lutheran Church in England. They are the ones that have a lesbian as the bishop of their denomination. They are the ones who have homosexual living with his, who left his wife and kids and living with his homosexual boyfriend in charge of their old dead demonic denominations. Way out of there. They deny the inerrancy of Scripture. They deny the virgin birth. They deny the deity of Christ. Now, I am not a Catholic. I'm not a supporter of the Catholic Church. The 90% of their teaching is unbiblical. But the Catholic Church does not deny the virgin birth of Christ. What they do is add their traditions and all that. So anyway, I'm going to make this next video. There are Catholics who are born again. Now, as I've said many times, why they don't leave that denomination, they should leave the Catholic Church and come out from among them. But as I said before, God has his witnesses. Even in those dead denominations with the gay bishops and all that, the Lord has his wheat there. He has his salt and light. He has his witnesses there. So what people need to do, and you need to break out of your paradigm and your religious thinking and all these things that people have told you. Because every individual gets saved. God has no grandchildren. He only has children. Each individual one of us needs to get saved. Each individual one of us give an account to God. Now, I believe all the different denominations, you know, I saw someone who's making comments, old denominations from the devil. Division in the church is from the devil. Now, denominations are supposed to be, hey, this is the doctrine we believe versus the doctrine, you know, assemblies of God started because they said, hey, we believe in speaking in tongues and the gifts of the Spirit, and we came from the Baptist. Well, there was one Baptist and one Methodist preacher that started the assemblies of God. And they got baptized in the Holy Spirit with speaking in tongues, and then they started denomination. Because, A, the Baptist guy said, hey, let's keep it rooted, grounded in the Word. Some of these, and lots of the Pentecostals, are running wild. Ungodly things. Oh, I feel like the Lord wants us to do this and that. Even though the Lord can speak to us, but instead of using the Word of God, they start superseding the Word of God with their spooky spiritualism. That's what's also on the YouTube. The YouTube is full of false prophets and people who are getting feelings from the Lord, ungodly, unbiblical things. Some, you know, as an example, a woman on YouTube says, oh, I believe the Lord told me I'm one of the 144,000 witnesses. Well, the Bible says it's 144,000 Israelite males. So you are saying that something you think God told you supersedes the Word of God. That's not possible, because God is not a man that he should lie, nor the Son of Man that he should repent. God is not a liar. His word is clear on that point. There's lots of things in the Bible that are not clear. Like I could say the Lord is leading me to go to the Philippines and be a missionary. Well, the Bible doesn't say whether I will or will not be a missionary in the Philippines. Now, some people may say, oh, well, you know, they can use some kind of Bible code. But the Bible doesn't spell out for me to go to the Philippines or not. So that's something that, yeah, we need to hear from the Lord about. Be led by the Spirit to go do it. But not cardinal doctrines. There are cardinal doctrines like salvation by grace through faith and all that. We can't hear anything from God that supersedes that. And the problem in the Pentecostal movement is people do not know the Word of God. From the Jesus movement in the same time period, it's 1970s, until today, the vast majority of Pentecostal people do not know the Word of God. That's why they're tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. That's why when Kenneth Copeland gets up there and says, you're a little God, they don't blink. I went to a conference one time. It was from the Toronto Blessing. They had a conference, and my prayer partner, and many of you guys who watch my videos, you know about this. There's a black church, and we started it. I was the only white person. I helped start it before I started working with Filipinos. The Lord was preparing me for that, working with a different culture and different group. And it was a transition for me. And I worked with, of course, I'm, you know, my age, of course, not like the old people before, you know, they lived in a segregated society. Of course, I went, you know, desegregated schools, and I was in the army and all that. So nothing like that, but talking about religious stuff and learning different traditions and all this. And he really was into the Toronto. So we went, Pastor Billy is his name. We went to this Toronto Blessing, and then they were doing all this, you know, do spiritual cleansing stuff, all this special breathing. And there was some old spooky spiritual, old goofy woman in front of me. And they were doing this, and I was saying to myself, you know, praise the Lord, bless the Lord, real low under my breath behind this woman. She turned around and told me, oh, don't you know that for this to happen, you can't speak. You have to open your mouth and breathe in and out. And then, you know, anything bad in you will go out. And then the Spirit will come into you and all this through your mouth. You're breathing in and out. You know, as if literally God goes through your breath, that the Lord couldn't enter your spirit, man, without going through your breath. It can go through your arm, you know, whatever. You know, some kind of nonsense, foolishness, man, nonsense. There's lots of spooky spiritual people. You know, they all team up with their nonsense. That's how they get in all this false doctrine. Okay, number one. Number two, as you know, I don't know why I'm doing this, but I'm going through the whole list here. The Baptist, we know, and like I said, Assemblies of God prides itself as a denomination at being rooted and grounded in the Word because of their Baptist beginning. Then the holiness comes from the Methodist. Together, being filled with the Holy Spirit, you know, that's where you get. You can rightly divide the Word with the Spirit. So the problem, as I said, as I talk about mostly, because I came from a Baptist background, the Baptist people are rooted and grounded in the Word, and then they turn around and reject the Spirit of God. They reject the gifts of the Spirit. They reject God as the I Am, and they want to say He's the I Was. I mean, that's really what they're doing. They're rejecting the move of the Spirit. So you got to allow the, quench not the Spirit, the Bible says, 1 Corinthians chapter 14. You know, forbid not the speaking of tongues. Quench not the Spirit. But the Bible, Paul also says in that same text, let the in 1 Corinthians 12 through 14, that the elders are supposed to judge every prophecy, whether it be from God or not. Every tongue's with interpretation. The elders are to judge that, whether it be from God or not. All these kind of things. So this is where people are getting off on all these tracks. And, you know, of course, everybody knows about the Mary worship and all that with the Catholic Church. We know all that. We know all this, you know, all of these layers and layers of false doctrine. But like I've told you before, if you've watched my videos, Martin Luther was a Catholic priest when he did his 95 Theses. John Huss, who was really one of the greatest men of God that ever lived outside biblical times, he was also a Catholic priest over there in Prague. Mighty man of God, Pentecostal, tongue-talking child of God. As a matter of fact, Martin Luther spoke in tongues too. He wrote it in his private memoirs, but he didn't teach it because it wasn't time for God to reintroduce that. Until where the modern Pentecostal movement started at Azusa Street Revival in 1906 in Los Angeles, of all places. Look how far the United States has fallen. The birthplace of the last great revival. People look at things in small seasons, just a few years. Oh, how arrogant we are to think about things that's happened in the last 5 years or 10 years. God moves in hundreds of years. 1906 was the great last move of God in the world. It began in 1906. The Pentecostal movement is on fire, moving throughout third world countries right now. In South America, millions and millions and millions of people are getting saved and baptized in the Holy Ghost through Assemblies of God and denominations like that, all through third world countries in the 1040 window, they call it. All you people on YouTube who are self-appointed preachers, they call it the 1040 window. That's the, you know, all this theological stuff. That's what they call it, where all the people who are by the millions coming to the Lord. So Christianity, Pentecostal Christianity is growing. The only part of Christianity that's really growing in the world, brothers and sisters. Anyway, so I started touching on my second message. I'll make a video about that. I started out talking about Bruce Jenner. Brothers and sisters, I have to go where the Lord's leading me. And I will be back with another video. I had a dream, as I said, about the old Pope Emeritus, Pope Benedict, the glory of the olive, the glory of the tribulation period, and the people that would follow him. They're going to do right, says the Lord. They will do right. They will do right. The Lord's just reminded me, because I worked with the Filipinos starting in 2003, and some of them were charismatic Catholics that came to the group that I had. And anyway, I'd given a word to them about the Pope, that this last Pope, Benedict, would be the last Pope that would be within the bounds of God's limit of dealing with people. And after that, the Catholic Church would go over the edge, which, of course, you know, it lines up with the prophecy, of the popes. I'll be back with that. It's an exciting message. I wanted to make this message about Bruce Jenner only because I wanted non-believers to see it, but the Lord directed me into talking Christianity more, you know. So maybe some non-believers saw this who are fans of transgenderism and all these things. So in the 1960s, as I said, in the 1950s and 60s, everything changed, brothers and sisters. That's what I wrote about in the book. You know, this, as Israel was becoming a nation, 48, and then they took the Temple Mount in 1967. At the same time, in the church, you had the Jesus movement begin, the charismatic movement, which is all the old denominations and Catholic Church, too, was some of the people getting baptized in the Holy Spirit. That was a whole movement. The problem with the charismatic movement, they're not rooted and grounded in the Word of God. That's the problem. That's where you get all these offshoots of wackiness. You know, people saying you need a spiritual enema and people getting down barking like a dog and all that. That's a charismatic movement, not your traditional Pentecostal people, you know, who are like Baptists who got filled with the Holy Spirit. So that's where. But God is the, you know, the one to deal with these people. It doesn't, you know, they're ignorant of what they're doing. You know, there's a difference between someone being a false teacher and someone that's a church member that's been in that church their whole life and don't know any different. And they're ignorant of some of these things that they're doing, you know. So that's, you know, the Lord is the judge of all this. So I'll be talking about that in the next video. And the Lord is giving me this message. So anyway, brothers and sisters, in the 1960s, you know, it really culminated in the popular culture with the Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band album. It was a transition of rock and roll from, you know, that it came in like a Trojan horse with I Want to Hold Your Hand. The Beatles did, and then transitioned to, by 1968, they're singing the song, Why Don't We Do It in the Road, and Helter Skelter and all that, and the White Album, they call it. All this transition, before that, they did this Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. Sgt. Pepper is none other than Aleister Crowley, and then his disciples were, I'm just going to, just to throw this out there for people that can research this, Jack Parsons, the head of JPL, that's a Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Why do they want to go to Mars? Because they're occultists and they think Mars, and I'm just repeating what's in my videos that I've been making over the last 4 years. Mars is the original abode of Lucifer before the fall. Mars is known as the God of War and all of that. So that's why they want to go to Mars. Jack Parsons was an occultist. He tried to do a sexual magic ceremony to bring forth the Antichrist. His assistant, his homosexual lover and assistants in this process was some virgin. Was none other than L. Ron Hubbard, the founder of Scientology, the freak, demonic, satanic freak that he was. These people are all Satanists, Luciferians, whatever you want to call them. They control Hollywood. You got Tom Cruise and all those people. That's why they want to do this War of the Worlds. What world are they talking about? The portal they're opening was CERN. And someone told me, oh, you need to talk about CERN. I've been talking about it for years. CERN, they tried to make a CERN down there in Texas in the 1980s when Bush Sr. was the president. It was all over the news all about it, how I could, you know, blew up the whole world and all this stuff. That's why they blocked it from happening in Texas. That's old news. You know, a lot of people are just now finding out about it. It's old stuff. Didn't you see the spiral in the sky the night that Obama got his Nobel Peace Prize over Norway? There was a spiral in the sky. I mean, that's what it is, a Stargate. Did you see that movie called Stargate? That's what they're talking about. That's what it is. They're going to open up that for the War of the Worlds, brothers and sisters. The War of the Worlds. I mean, the virus is the blood of Jesus. You know, what the devil would call a virus is the blood of Jesus that would kill the invasion. You know, the Lord would kill this War of the Worlds, brothers and sisters. They look at it backwards. And I'm jumping topics here. Because lots of you guys are so carnal-minded, you have no spiritual hearing or sight or heart. When, listen, this is so easy. That's why Jesus said you got to become like a little child. In the book of Daniel, when King Nebuchadnezzar had his dream about the kingdoms of the world, you know, the statue, he saw gold and silver and bronze and iron and clay and iron mixed together. Daniel, later on in the book of Daniel, Daniel had a dream of those same kingdoms, but he saw them as beasts. They were beasts. So in the eyes of man and the eyes of Satan, it's always the opposite. They call good evil and evil good. That's why they think Bruce Jenner is so awesome, because they see it through the eyes of Satan. They're deluded. They're deceived. They think all these things are great, but in actuality, they are calling evil good and good evil. They're blinded. And so many Christians can't. They're carnal minded. You can't see spiritually what's right and wrong. But even, like I say, you don't even have to be spiritually anointed. That's the fastest, easiest way to understand these things. But what's the worst is people that are not spirit filled and don't know the word. That's where you get these old mainline denominations who are not charismatic. An old mainline denominational person who is not charismatic. You get the worst of both worlds. I'm not talking about Baptists. Baptists know the Word of God, rooted and grounded in the Word of God. I'm talking about those old mainline Protestant denominations, and then old Catholics too. Catholics learn the catechism and all that of the Catholic Church. As a matter of fact, there's several priests who have become saved and came out of the Catholic Church, and they've given their testimony. You can see it on YouTube. And they told what I already knew. They testified what I already knew, just from common sense. When they went to seminary, they never used the Bible. They studied all the writings of the church fathers and the catechism. They became experts at the catechism. They are preachers, proclaimers of the Catholic Church catechism, of course. The old mainline denominations, what do they use? The Westminster Confessional. They use their own doctrine books to teach out of. As I've mentioned this many times, if you listen to R.C. Sproul, who I like, he's a very smart man. He is a Calvinist. He's a Presbyterian. But what does he do? He quotes from, Thomas Aquinas. He quotes from all these men. He's not quoting from the Bible. He's quoting the philosophies of men who are looking through a glass darkly. Some of them are right and some of them are wrong. But they are just giving a poor reflection of the true light, the Word of God. All these high-minded theologians. You know, there's people on YouTube who call themselves theologians. But a theologian is someone that is a doctor of theology. I am not a theologian. You know, I only have a four-year degree. You have to be called a theologian, a high theologian scholar, you need to be a doctor, a professor of theology to be a theologian. And these are the people, they spend all of their time learning and following these different schools of theology of what man has been writing. The religion, man-made rules to try to get to God. Man-made understandings upon man-made understandings. That's how you get to where you get the Jesuits. That's how you end up with a theory of evolution and all these things. When you get so far out on a scaffolding of half-truths, you're no more rooted and grounded in the truth, which Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to the Father but by Him, not by denominations or preachers or Darwinism or whatever you can think of, Jesuitism or the Pope or whomever. Someone may feel like they can come to God by it. It's definitely not by, salvation is not by liberation of gender. That is not salvation. That is a temporary, delusional, false satisfaction in the flesh. AKA the short word that everybody knows, sin. Calling sin great and calling holiness evil. That's where the world is today, brothers and sisters. It didn't happen overnight. But if you would follow these patterns, you can see. You know, that's why you talk about where's it going. That's why I like Alex Jones. I don't care what anybody, I don't want to hear any comments of what anybody thinks. If you don't listen to him, you don't know what you're talking about. Not what some moron said on YouTube. Alex Jones, he follows the patterns. He reads the books. Now we're talking about politics, not Christianity. He reads the books written by the Illuminati people, what their plans are, like Mein Kampf. Hitler wrote in the 1920s what he was going to do. That's why Winston Churchill said, read Mein Kampf during World War II. He said the greatest thing every leader needs to do is read Mein Kampf, because Hitler laid out his plan. All of these wacky, delusional, demonic, satanic people, they tell you what they're going to do. The Rockefellers, the Rothschilds, all of those people in the past have written books exactly what their game plan is, exactly what they got from Lucifer, their God, and what they intend on doing. You can follow the patterns of their game plan. You can follow the patterns of what God's doing. God is restoring his church just like it was on the day of Pentecost. And I've said this many times, and I tell you, by the Spirit of the living God, the church was mysteriously and suddenly, without warning, conceived and birthed and born and filled with the Spirit on one day, what we call Pentecost. And the church will suddenly, mysteriously, and without warning or sign, disappear, just like it appeared on the day of Pentecost. And brothers and sisters, all, and that's another thing people don't know what they're talking about. There are no signs for the rapture. Every sign that the Lord gave us and the Bible gives us is for the second return of Christ. The tribulation itself and all the parts of it are signs and warnings that the Lord's about to return to judge the quick and the dead. But the rapture happens before that, and there is no signs for that. That's why the Lord said he would come as a thief in the night. The second coming, every eye will see him. Every tribe will mourn because, oops, I took the mark. Whoops, wrong. Jesus was right. Those Christians were right. Jesus is the Christ. He's the Messiah. He's God. Whoops. But when he comes for the church, he's coming as a thief in the night to meet us in the air. When he comes back at the end, he will step down on the earth. Terra firma is the Latin word. He will land up there on the Mount of Olives. Zechariah 14. And it will split in two. And he will walk right in there to the Temple Mount through the Eastern Gate. And he will rule and reign for 1,000 years from right there. Brothers and sisters, that's what's going to happen. But before that will be the 7-year tribulation. And in the God's view, God is restoring all things unto himself. What did he tell us in Daniel? The 70th week of Daniel is what? To put an end to sin. All those things. 70 weeks are determined for your people. And then Gabriel gives a list. That last 70th week is the process of God restoring creation back to like it was in the Garden of Eden. Removing sin and all those things. That's what God's going to be doing. That's the process that God is doing that we call the tribulation period. God is restoring his creation and removing the Antichrist and his people from this earth and all those who have rebelled against God. That's what's going to be happening. But before that, the church will be removed, brothers and sisters. The church will be raptured, will be out of here in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Hallelujah. At the last trump, what last trump? The last trump of the church age, brothers and sisters, because when Paul wrote that about 40 years before the book of Revelation was written, first rule of interpretation for all of you people that you try to use that text out of your ignorance. First rule of interpretation. What the meaning to the original audience is cannot be done away with. So when Paul wrote that the church would be gone at the last trump, there is no way he could have been referring to the last trumpet judgment in Revelation, because that book wasn't written for 40 more years. His audience would have had no idea what he was talking about. There's no way that's what it meant. It goes against everything to do with high theological biblical interpretation and rules of interpretation that's been held since the foundation of the church, brothers and sisters, friends, Romans and countrymen. God bless you all. Hallelujah. I got to speak the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth. So help me God by his grace, by his mercy. Hallelujah. Time to get right. Time is up. Time is over. Time to get right with God. God's not playing. God's not joking. Hell's still smoking. And it's coming. The wrath of God abides on those, Jesus said, who have rejected him as the Messiah. I'll be back, brothers and sisters. I have to make another video about the dream I had about Pope. The glory of the olive, referring to Matthew chapter 24, the Olivet discourse, the glory of the tribulation, the leader of the tribulation saints during the tribulation of the Gentile tribulation saints. You better look to some Catholics, says the Lord, because the Lord has his remnant there. Don't believe what all these people are saying. Yeah, we know you can't cookie cutter everybody. You can't cookie cutter everybody. As I just mentioned, those Gentile Pentecostal, alleged Pentecostal preachers who are supporting this Pope. God bless you guys. I've been rolling with it. Hopefully this video will process and it'll be loaded this morning. It's nighttime here. It's 7 o'clock at night here. It's 7 o'clock in the morning there. Monday morning, April the 26th, whatever it is, 25th. God bless you guys.